Today we're going to be talking about the geological resources of Somalia, and this is in partnership with Association of Somali Engineers. We are a UK-based organisation that is a platform for both students and professionals to collaborate, share ideas and to network, and we aim to bolster levels of engineering awareness and employability within the community and to promote and develop engineering services and best practice for sustainable development. And today our speaker, Dr. Osman Salad Hersi, for those of you that don't know, he initially got his first geology degree from the Somali National University. After that, he had a scholarship to study at Florence University in Italy, where he gained his PhD. After a while, he went to Carleton University in Canada, where he got a second degree in sedimentology and sedimentary basin analysis. Now he works at the University of Regina, and he has over 200 papers in peer-reviewed journals, book chapters, conference abstracts, open file reports, consultancy reports, and institutional publications. Dr. Hersi, in his current role alongside his university, is a consultant for the petroleum industry, in which he has worked with the Puntland State of Somalia and the Federal Government of Somalia, in which he is still adamant to continue. Today's lecture will be held in English. However, we do hope that our future events, we're able to speak in Somali. So thank you, Dr. Osman, you can start.
Well, Kas, mineral and rock resources. Mineral and rock resources. The minerals and rock resources, again, back to the geological map of Somalia. And again, the different colors are there. Geological map, it shows the surface distribution of rocks. When we see here any geologist, maybe a geologist that is born and grown up and studied geology in New Zealand, if he or she gets the map of Somalia, that person can understand what type of rocks are there, where they occur, how deep and what lies under the surface, kind of reading the geological map. And also the cross-sections that are shown here are showing the different layers and different types of rocks that are lying one under the other one. So that is the different types of, so it shows the distribution of the rocks, whether they are igneous, metamorphic or sedimentary rocks, and also the structures. If there are faults and folds and all these things, they show that structures as well. So geologists can also infer what is in beneath surface. Yeah, under it, we have ka hooseeya nataqaana midabkan dhagaxa leh wixii ka sii hooseeya waynu garan karnaa. Haddaan xusuusta waxaan idhi meelahan colorfulka ah waa dhagaxa ugu duqsan labadan, marka iyaga ugu daweyn ha muuqdeen, laakiin waxaa dul saaran dhagaxii sedimentariga ahaa oo kuwaan dhan waxay ka sarreeyaan dhagaxii sedimentariga ahaa. So two major regions that expose crystalline rocks, we have seen the Gulf region, the Bur region, in a lower melod or basement rocks ka kitchen. And indeed, these two regions are the most potential when it comes to the minerals, whether it is gemstones or industrial minerals. These two regions are by far the most interesting ones. The highly potential ones are these two regions. The rest of the Somalia, as I said, is covered by sedimentary rocks. Sedimentary rocks have their own benefits, and I'll talk that one, but in terms of minerals and even different types of rocks, it is these two regions that are indeed very attractive. So again, the details of that map. One example that I would like to give you, in the Bur region is what is called the banded iron formation. Banded iron formation. If you look at the map, see these kind of black zones, this one, you have also a few others. See, these are black zones. So if you look, that means the banded iron formation. So this black zones, these are rocks that contain iron, the metal iron. And here I give you an example of one mountain there called Bur Galan in the local accent, or Bur Galin in the Mahatri accent. So Bur Galan or Bur Galin is here. And actually people call burqalin because of maybe the colorful it is and how it looks like, and it's kind of a black in color. Yeah. So that bur, I do remember I visited when I was a student at the Somali National University in Mogadishu. And what our instructor told us that time was that it is height that we can see from the surface high. It's about 300 meters high. And it is 25 kilometers long and 6 kilometers wide. So simply looking what is visible in a three-dimensional way, it is 300 meters by 25 kilometers by 6 kilometers. And the grade of the iron content, the iron that contains is called hematite. It's iron oxide, pure iron oxide. So it's about 35.4 to 45.4%, the amount it contains. And if you simply, what is exposed here, if you simply change that one into cubic meter, simply multiply 300 meters by 25,000 meters by 6,000 meters times 0.354, which is the percentage, that gives you 15.93 billion cubic meter. It's only that burqalin. Imagine, that's the steel that we can produce, the iron ore, the hematite that we can produce from that is 15.93 billion metric tons. What about if we add all those other occurrences and outcrops that are present there? And actually, when we say these are 6 kilometer wide, it's called the height 300 meter, that we do not know how deep it goes from the surface. It could be way deeper and much more. And therefore, in the billions and billions of cubic meters of iron could be there. And add now these other outcrops that are present there. See, here we have two outcrops, here we have one, here's another one, another. All these kind of black zones are these banded iron formations. Yeah, it's quite a very rich zone in terms of the iron content. The other minerals that are present in the Bur region include uranium in the Aliyogel zone. Phosphate is there as well. Quartz, the quartzite of Qabrikusho. There's another mountain called Qabrikusho, which is quartzite. And also there are minor trace elements. This is, I got this information from a work done by Dr. Haider et al., published by Haider et al., Abdullah Haider, my colleague at the university in Somalia in those old days. So that includes the aluminum and titanium, chromium, sodium, barium, manganese, zinc, cobalt, nickel. So he identified the presence of these, but as a minor and trace elements, but it may require further research to see where the concentration could be higher. So that exists there. In the northern part of the country, these are again the basement rocks that are present there. And there are quite a good number of minerals that are present there. And here we have the pigmatite forms. Pigmatite is not a mineral by itself, but it's a veins with very large coarse crystalline minerals that can contain different types of minerals. It can contain gold, it can contain zinc, and so on and so forth. So it can contain a good number of. Here, the staniferous veins, or what's called the tin, is the very good example. Is the Majayahan and Dalam tin. See, if you use these kind of dots, they are present there. Here is Majayahan, and this one is Dalam. Dalam is south of Las Khoray, south of El Ayu, actually. And this one is south of Bosaso. So this contains tin. Not only that, but traces of gold and zinc and copper are also mentioned in the papers published from these rocks. Yeah. Quartz veins are there with gold-bearing pyrite. If you look, you can simply look at this kind of a sign. If you can get here's one. For instance, in the Gedeble area and Gebile, Gedeble, that area, quartz veins with gold-bearing pyrite would be there. Yeah. titanomagnetite are there. Here, platinum group elements are there as well. Disseminated veins, molybdenum and bismuth are there. Carbonatite veins. These carbonatite veins need more research because carbonatites are rocks that may contain, or maybe associated with the diamond-bearing minerals. So these kind of triangles, maybe you can look where the triangles occur. Maybe I can find it somewhere. Yeah, maybe here. Yeah. So anyway, it has been recognized that presence of carbonatite veins may be quite small in volume, but they may contain with niobium, ortite, zircon, they may contain stratiform manganese as well. So manganese could be there as well. Stratiform copper, volcanic massive sulfides. This needs more work, and these VMS sulfides can be present there. The zinc sulfide, lead sulfide. These sulfides could be present there. Scheelite is another kind of a calcium-rich wolframite, it's called. So it can contain there minerals and anomalies. Kyanite and polymetallic stratiform. Here we have copper, ferruginous copper as well, stratiform manganese. So there are quite these different types of minerals. But again, this is work has been done some long time ago. This is from Fritzo, I think, 1993, I guess, that's what I referenced. But it requires, each zone requires more of a detailed mapping in areas. For instance, if we look at these pegmatites, you see these kind of S-shaped symbols, quite very common throughout. They need to be checked very deeply and with great details. Yeah. And they may contain very useful minerals. So more work is done, because here the scale of the map does not show the details that are required for actual mineral concentration and great kind of analysis. So it requires much more localized and kind of a good scale to cover that. Also, a work done by Dr. Abdullah Jama Adam, 1993 and 1996, he published their papers. He mentioned that in the Barkasan area, as between Berbera and Hargeisa, there's the platinum group elements. There's also nickel and titanium, yeah. So these minerals are mentioned in these two papers as well. Abdullah currently lives in Sweden, and he published these papers. So maybe he may have kind of copies of these papers. So that is the mineral aspect. The other kind of useful rocks, there are so many different types of rocks we have seen, whether granite and gabbro, marble, slates, gneiss, quartzite, and also sediment rocks. So these are the igneous rocks and metamorphic rocks. And of course, when we say igneous and metamorphic, where we look for is those two regions, the Bur region and the Gulf Range. These are the two basement rocks that is exposed. So the granite is quite present there. And these are quite very useful as a production of a cement for the limestone, glasses for the quartz. We have the sandstone and the quartzite, production of glasses, dry walls for the gypsum. This is the Taleh formation. I visited in 2014 there. This is the road towards, I think between Gardo and Bosaso somewhere, yeah. And this is limestone, shale, sandstone. This is the Cretaceous to Paleocene strata. So the limestone is the major ingredient for the production of cement. So we do have plenty everywhere, and everywhere in the country, the limestone is there. And we can produce cement from there, although it requires a huge amount of energy. So that's one thing, yeah. We have also coal. Here's a coal, here's the granite. So we do have these different types of rocks, and it can be done with the tiles, yeah, and countertops, the floor tiles, the walls. So they can be useful. They can be marbles, but very expensive. The granite tiles are very expensive. Slates and gneiss, quartzite, all these are quite very useful and expensive. But it requires industry that we set into the region, and and produce these materials. Okay, yeah, here some slides from the coal in northern Somalia is from Ergab area. The coal, this is from a paper written by Dr. Muhammad Ali. Is there also coal from Durbo area near Gandala? So this poor guy, he's kind of digging it, but you can use that one as a source of energy.